Luminary presents Therapy versus the World. I'm your host, Joe Nucci, and together with the help of our very special guests, we are going to tackle some of the more emotionally difficult topics of your life. We're going to contextualize and interpret all of this therapy speak that you hear about, everything from narcissism to self-esteem to attachment styles and more. Hopefully, you understand yourself and others just a little bit better after each episode. Today, I'm very excited to talk to model and content creator Paul Aaron Fischer. Paul and I actually connected over DM after I saw this amazing video of him talking about male beauty standards and how they've become untenable. If you haven't seen the video, we're going to play it for you right now.
Has anyone ever come to think about how much social media actually changed our perception of what a good physique is? I remember when I saw the first Spider-Man movie, just when Tobey Maguire got all his powers and he's jacked all of a sudden. Back then, I thought he looked really good. And when I look at him now, he looks like a little boy to me. I remember the first time I saw a picture of Patrick Bateman, I thought this must be one of the greatest physiques I've seen in my life. And when I look at him now, I feel like it's all right. There's nothing special. Social media and the crazy steroid culture has created some insane standards. Like, so much so that when I look at my own physique, I feel like I look slightly above average at best, even though I dedicate so much of my life to it. I don't know. It's kind of fucked up. And I wonder where it will go, where it will stop.
Well, welcome, Paul. I'm so excited to talk to you. Tell us, before we get into the video, where are you from? How did you get into modeling? What else are you up to in the world? Tell us about yourself.
Well, hello. I'm very, very excited to be here. I'm very happy to have my first podcast experience here. So my name is Paul Aaron Fischer. I'm originally from Austria. I'm fully Austrian. My parents are both from here. I'm 26 years old. I was studying business administration for the last 4 years. And I started modeling when I was about 21 or so. I got signed by my first agency, so about 5 years ago. And I've been modeling and studying pretty much simultaneously for 4 years. Then I finished my studies, thankfully, finally. And then I started into full-time modeling. And with that, I had a little bit of free time at the moment. And then I also started to... connect my passions to, I always wanted to create videos, and I always loved to cook. So in the beginning, I connected that and I started creating on TikTok and Instagram, and it's been going really well. And I gained quite a few followers, and then I sort of explored other areas of content creation, and also a bit like videos that make you think. Also, I have a few of those, and that is in part the video that you're talking about.
Yeah, well, let's talk about that video. When I saw it, I thought it was absolutely ingenious. I love the Spider-Man franchise, and the examples you used of Tobey Maguire after he gets bit by the spider and he kind of goes into that like feverish sleep and he wakes up and he's all ripped. I also remember at the time thinking, wow, that's a really great body. And I also share with what you're saying, which is, and I don't really know exactly when the switch happened for most people, but it seems like everything from filters, from using steroids and different things, or from at the very least only posting pictures of yourself when you're, you know, dehydrated and have a pump from the gym and the lighting is exactly perfect, and all of these things. I was talking to a colleague of mine, and they were saying, I thought it was so insightful. They were saying, sometimes I go on social media or I go on dating apps and I think to myself, wow, I really need to take my health a little bit more seriously. I need to go to the gym a little bit more. But then I actually go to the bar or go to the event or go to the function. And it's not even that people look bad. It's just compared to these photos, it's like everyone looks a little frumpy. You know what I mean? And it's a little, and it's kind of this weird game theory thing where if you're not doing those angles and those filters and those different things, you may not actually be getting as much attention, especially if you're using something like dating apps or if it's that. And so it's the way you were able to contextualize that shift for me using those pop culture examples of Tobey Maguire, with Patrick Bateman, with just everything that's been going on, it really hit me in a way. And the fact that you are a model and work in this industry, mm-hmm. and that even you're noticing it, I'm so excited to talk to you about it again. We already did an Instagram live, but that was just my initial reaction to it.
Yeah, I do think the Tobey Maguire one really struck a nerve. I don't know. I feel like a third of the comments are about that reference. But it just goes to show how far everything has come, because, you know, we all, like, at least my generation, a bit above, we grow up with the Spider-Man, with Tobey Maguire being Spider-Man, and we all saw him in the cinema, and I think we were all impressed with this transformation overnight, and we were all like, wow, okay, all of a sudden he looks completely ripped and muscular. And I remember back then just thinking, oh my god, if I could ever achieve this physique, I would have done it. I mean, I would look amazing. And, you know, with me being sort of just on social media in general, but also sort of a fitness enthusiast, I just didn't realize how much I got plastered with, as you say, people who are perfectly like dieted down exactly to that point, stood in perfect lighting, and then took one picture, and how much I got plastered with pictures like that, and how much I indoctrinated that this is a normal healthy fit body. I just never realized it, and sort of initiated the whole idea for the video is that I was just working out in my and I was just looking at my body, and I was like, yeah, okay, I look great, but who doesn't have a six pack at this point in this world? And then I was like, what? Like, what? This is like, it's incredibly hard to achieve. What am I saying even? And when it really struck is when on YouTube I saw this scene from Spider-Man again, and I remembered it, and I looked at Tobey Maguire after he got his superpowers, was all buff all of a sudden, and I looked at him and I was like, he looks like a little boy. This is not at all what I remembered. And yeah, then I sort of started thinking, Nick Bateman is also a model that I followed back when I was like, I don't know, 15 or something, that I was super impressed by. His physique was the gold standard for me. And I also went back to him, to his Instagram profile, and I was underwhelmed, to say the least. If he hears this, no offense.
Well, it's not even so much about him. It's a commentary on the frequency of that physique and that ideal, if you will.
Exactly. And that even for me, as someone who works in the fashion industry, someone who has, for his job, has to take care of his body a lot and who works out a lot, that I felt not much more than average with my physique anymore, just went to show me how far social media went and what it does to your brain when you're constantly plastered with this beauty ideals and beauty standards.
Yeah. Well, I want to contextualize what it's doing to the brain a little bit from my perspective, but can you tell me a little bit about, you just talked about the awareness that you started to have, that you were looking at your body differently, maybe your internal monologue about yourself was different. Can you say a few more things about what that was like for you? Was it surprising? Was it difficult? How did you, are you still there? Do you still kind of feel that way about how you look, or do you feel like making the video and being more conscious of this dynamic has helped? I would love to know a little bit about your mental health piece as it relates to all of this.
Well, my mental health journey with my body has been going on for a long time. And I don't know, I always feel like I'm doing very well with this at this point. I'm older now, and I've reflected a lot on all of these issues. But then I still catch myself thinking these things, thinking that my body is not good enough, and that just that if this were different, I would be a happier person. And so, in some ways, it's still going on. I have to say it's been getting a lot better with getting older and with getting more acceptance of myself and how I look like. And In terms of the video, I have to say it helped. It helped to get, because it kind of went viral, right? And
it definitely went viral.
it kind of helped for me to see that there's so many people who resonate with that and who were like, yeah, wow, true, yeah. So that was sort of reassuring for me that a lot of people go through this and that a lot of people are viewing their bodies differently with all of the glamour and the perfection on social media. But honestly, it's hard, and I feel like you have to be you constantly have to make yourself aware of this, because it's very easy to slip back into this mm-hmm. habit of just looking at perfection all day long and letting it get letting it be your new normal. Oh.
From your perspective, someone who is not just a model, but you're also a content creator, you have a business degree. What is perfection to you in terms of looks, or even something more broadly? What is your version of that?
My version of perfection, that is a hard question, honestly.
Yeah. Put another way, if you're looking at how you look and you're dissatisfied, what precisely is so dissatisfying? Is it that you wish you were, like, sometimes you wish you were bulkier? Is it more about, like, body fat percentage? Like, I'm just kind of curious, like, what,
you mean,
like,
actual what, like, what examples do you see? Of it.
Yeah.
Honestly, for me, it's actually kind of funky, because I see changing over day. I see it changing in specific lights. Something I really don't like about myself is my nose. I don't know. Some people, weirdly enough. About my body, it's just a thing. It really, like, I can have very different mental states about my body in a single day, just depending on the light I look at myself in. But of course, always, I always feel like I could be leaner. I saw that model on Instagram. He has much better shoulders than me. I wish my eyes were blue. My eyes are so boring. And like, I don't know. It just comes up with, if I just could have that, and if I just could have that.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's right. Weird, because I actually did this at some point where I went through. I'm at my parents' house right now, and there's, like, a lot of mirrors in the different rooms, and look at myself in different mirrors in different rooms and feeling very different about myself in these different mirrors. So I don't know. It's just so weird how your perception of all of that changes all the time.
Well, part of it is completely understandable, right? Because if you're competing for contracts or gigs as a model, you're constantly getting compared, and you're not getting compared on the ideas you have in your head or the,
personality,
the substance of your heart. It's you're a model, and I'm not going to crap on the beauty industry for that. That is what it's about. It is about, you know, the outward appearance. So part of that is very understandable. I also think that part of it is quite vulnerable, because I also know from your comment section specifically on that video, while a ton of people resonated with it as a fellow content creator, I also understand some people don't, and they make their opinion known. And I think that some people might listen to this conversation and they might say, well, gee, that sure is nice that Paul can talk about, you know, his insecurities looking like how he looks, but, you know, he doesn't really get the severity of this problem, or he really shouldn't be the spokesperson for this problem. Have you responded to those criticisms? And if you haven't, like, what might you say?
I tend not to get too much into my comment section, because I feel like it gets out of control very quickly. But to that, I would say, first of all, the internet is a place where people sometimes get their own anger out of the way, and I tend to not take it personally. But I would say that it wouldn't matter who I am. If I made that video, people would comment on me. It could be that they say that I'm just jealous, that I'm not working hard enough, that I'm bitter and resentful in that way. I think it wouldn't matter. And I felt like, for me, working in the beauty and fashion industry, maybe it's a good take to for people to see that that me as I as well have these doubts, have these insecurities. And I just like the thought that even being a part of the problem, but then making myself also part of the solution in that same way. And that's what I try to do. I understand what these people are coming at, but I also feel like if people follow me for my looks, for my workout routines, it's maybe beneficial for them to see that even that I as well have these thoughts and these insecurities and these doubts about myself.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think you're doing that right now in this episode. I really liked your comment earlier about how the thoughts you have about your body changes based on the day, based on the lighting, based on, I mentioned, you know, being dehydrated earlier. It's one of the, I was in an interview with Hugh Jackman in Wolverine. I remember him giving where he was saying, he's like, I'm super dehydrated in those shots because I really wanted, you know, they wanted like my veins to pop and stuff like that. And something, it may sound silly, but before I started becoming a content creator, I had this idea about myself that I just can't take a good photo. You know, I need to filter. I can't take a good photo. And really what I was doing wrong is I didn't have the right lighting and the right angle. And I think anyone can take a phenomenal photo in the right lighting and in the right angle. And, it you know, like, you know, lights and angles, you know, I've seen so much footage of myself and from so many different angles, from B-roll and then just, you know, personal selfies that are like not for my professional content. It's you can sometimes look like a completely different person. And so the instability of, what am I trying to say? the psychologist's way to say it is it's something like the unstable self-image in today's world. In some ways, it may not be healthy, but in some ways, I think it is normative since we view so much of our world and ourselves through our phones and through pictures and through videos. And really, the light, the angle, it all matters. I also, you know, really want to take this moment to normalize this idea that at least on my own fitness journey, I don't know if you can relate, but there's actually like a range. Like there will be weeks where I'm like, you know, eating more and maybe I'm bulking. Maybe I'm just not being as disciplined. Maybe I'm just hungrier that week or whatever. And, you know, I will gain a certain amount of weight, you know, for a few weeks and then kind of drop. It's like no one's weight and body is stable all of the time. You know, like you probably, I imagine you actually like prep for competitions or if you like have a shoot, like there are like ways to go about it.
For competition, you know? Sounds like I'm a bodybuilder.
Maybe models don't do that. Maybe I'm mistaken, but I know, but bodybuilders do.
No, obviously, obviously that's a big part of it. And I have gotten like anxiety over my weight fluctuation. As you say, it's a completely normal part of your life. You have more water retention, you ate more. I don't know. There's so many things that affect your weight, and sometimes my mood is just determined by the number of this on the scale in the morning.
Can I ask something to you at that point?
Because I mean, I work in the modeling and fashion industry, and I do get judged on my appearance a lot. But I feel like as a content creator on the internet, on Instagram, the judgment of appearance is much more shameless, honestly, and much more personal. And I wanted to ask you what you think that does to creators when they know that in order for them or in order for their videos to perform well, they know that they have to be being attractive helps, and that they know that they that their video will do better if they're perceived as an attractive person. What do you think that does to them psychologically, to content creators?
I mean, I'm just going to make it up a little bit. Here are the different ways my mind, the different directions my mind goes in. So the first thing is that my first video that went viral was my 14th video. And it was, speaking of lighting and angles, I was really just starting out. So the lighting was horrible. Like the mic was horrible.
We don't talk about those first videos.
it's actually still pinned to the top of my reels. At least the repost of it is, because it was my 14th video ever. It got like a million views before it fell off the algorithm. And the video was about, don't listen to everything you think. not all of your thoughts come from a deep place that are worthy of analysis. Some thoughts are random. Let them go in one ear and out the other. And it resonated with so many people. And I remember that first day, because I think it got something like 130,000 views the first day. And at this point, I don't even think I had 1,000 followers. So that was crazy engagement to see. And it was the first time it had happened to me. And I remember feeling so good. And people talk about dopamine and the dopamine from the likes and the dopamine from the views. And it's interesting because in some ways the goalpost kind of moves. I think I got, you know, a few hundred thousand views like a week or two ago on a video about a different topic. And I mean, it didn't even register. I was just like, well, that's just expected now, you know? And,
oh my God.
You know,
yeah,
that's something I can
relate,
you know,
to that.
That's something I could maybe explore like in my own therapy or with other content creators that get it like you.
My thinking
is that there's something about excess positive emotion. Someone with bipolar, whether it's bipolar 1 or 2 or just kind of in the bipolar family, there's mania and then there's depression. And one way to think about this type of mental disorder is that there's excess negative emotion and excess positive emotion. And that's very, very oversimplified. But what I really want to get at is when you're in a manic or hypomanic state, you actually have excess positive emotion. I cannot remember the psychologist I saw on YouTube who explained it that way, but he said something like, you think that the point of life is to be happy? Have you ever seen a person in mania or hypomania? And then he plays a clip of someone and they're super like disoriented and some of the things they're saying that don't make any sense, but they're so happy. I mean, it feels so good. And one of the challenges of treating mania is that it actually feels really good. They don't often want to go on their meds because they're sleeping less and they feel creative and they feel sexual and they feel maybe even grandiose, like they're really confident, like they can do anything. And that is pretty fun.
Yeah,
the bad part
sounds fun.
About that. Totally. But the bad part about it is, number one, they're often not getting proper sleep, and that can be very bad for their brain long term. Number two, the excess positive emotion can lead to delusions of grandeur. So basically they can start to have beliefs about themselves that actually aren't based in reality. And in really extreme circumstances, people can think that they have certain powers or that they're God or whatever it is. It can almost take on these psychotic-like features. But three, there's also the crash that happens. And so I'm thinking about the bipolar spectrum and I'm thinking about excess of positive emotion as you ask, what will this do to content creators, or maybe this is just people with any sort of fame or any sort of public image getting all of that dopamine. Our brains are plastic. And I sometimes think about over time, a question I have is it a good thing or is it a bad thing that I become desensitized to that 200,000 viewed video? Yeah. Because on one hand, the goalpost has moved. And so I wonder what that does to my self-esteem or to how I think about my work or how I think about my strategy or my purpose and impact. I'm very impact oriented in a lot of my content. But then on the other side of it, I'm kind of like, oh, well, you know, maybe this is actually a good thing I'm desensitized. Because I remember when that first video hit, I didn't sleep very much that night. And I'm not saying that I'm on the bipolar spectrum. I'm not, but I just remember I was just so pumped up. You know, there was just so much adrenaline and cortisol in a good way that it really did affect me. And so there's something about excess positive emotion that I've been thinking a lot about and exploring from the content creator's perspective. Because if that felt that good, you can imagine what it feels like for people who get canceled, you know, a video of them doing something embarrassing, that excess negative emotion. No wonder why people struggle with their mental health after something like that. And that's a risk that anyone with a public presence has to contend with, that, you know, the wrong tweet or a video you didn't know was being recorded of you, or, you know, an off-color joke or whatever it might be, that could be not just devastating because you would be the cancel person of the moment, but it could, you know, depending on what your work is, it could even affect your livelihood. And that's a ton of pressure. And so I've also have thought about that. What do you think about all of that? That was just kind of a riff for me. I haven't really meditated on this topic in a while.
But that was insanely interesting. I didn't know that about manic people, that it actually can feel very good at some mm-hmm. point. But
yeah.
First of all, I'm very happy that you said that, and that I'm apparently not the only one who gets desensitized. Because when the first video goes viral, you just feel like over the moon. Yeah, mm-hmm. you feel over the moon, and it's and it's just amazing how fast that declines and how fast you take things for mm-hmm. granted, and then you're like, oh, this only has like 1,000 likes. Come on, guys, we're like, what is happening? Is this all gonna end? And I haven't really dared to think about, like, if you fly high, then you can fall very deep. Mm-hmm. But I think it's a very scary thought that this high feeling that you can get can also reverse if it all gets taken away. I don't know. I mean, it would just take some mean person buying you like 1,000,000 bots, and they just flood your Instagram, and then mm-hmm. nothing works anymore, and the algorithm doesn't want you anymore or whatever, and it's all taken away. And I feel like that's a very scary thought for me, because it is, I don't know, it is the attention that you get, and also the approval that you get is in a way is addicting, and mm-hmm. yeah, I don't know, it's a scary thought to me that it could all go the other way exactly like that, and that it's no wonder that if that happens to people, that creates mental problems in that sense.
Yeah. The Instagram live we did when we talked about some of these topics, it actually inspired a video I made. I don't know if you caught it, but I was talking about your distinction around the fitness industry and how part of it's almost understandable, dare I say forgivable, because if you're competing for that contract or that gig, you want to have that edge. You want the more daring eyes. You want the better cut on the shoulders. Like whatever it is that's going to set you apart, that's really what the people are looking for. And that's will, you know, also drive engagement, depending on if it's for an advertisement or for someone that you're wearing or whoever it is. But I was thinking about that, and I started to get a little bit concerned about it in terms of mental health and self-help, which is mm-hmm. a lot of what we understand about mental health and self-help. And we certainly don't understand everything, but we do understand a heck of a lot. And the idea that you need to kind of reinvent the wheel or make it just a little bit more shocking or a little bit more engaging. And it's my concern is not even that it's tomorrow or even next year that I will put something out there or consider putting something out there that is unethical or untrue or shocking for shocking stake. It's
more that my patient's medical records.
It's more like if we continue down this path and it's just little by little in 5 years, in 10 years, what does it actually mm-hmm. look like? You know? And I recently had a podcast interview with my friend Max Friedlich. He's a playwright. He wrote a play that's set over a therapy session. So we had him on the podcast, and he said something so beautiful. He talked about how, yes, all this is a concern, but also the internet seems to have this nose for authenticity that makes things go mm-hmm. very, very viral. And I think your video is actually a wonderful example of that, where you were just kind of like, hey, like, this is what I think. This is something I'm concerned about. It didn't feel overly rehearsed. It felt very genuine. And that's one of your most viewed videos.
Mm-hmm. It is.
You know,
it is my second most viewed video.
Yeah. The question, I would love your thoughts on it, is are we mm-hmm. concerned that we'll continue to get desensitized and things will have to get more extreme? Or do we also have hope that even though that's happening now, there a lot of viral videos aren't necessarily the overly curated, super extreme, edgy fitness model, therapist, whoever it is. People do have this nose and this need for authenticity.
I do agree on that. I think it's something to be aware of, that this pushing it to the extreme is something that is in the back of our minds to just like stir up a little bit of dust again and try to make people look at us again. But what makes me very hopeful in that sense is to see where the TikTok or Instagram trends are actually going, and that this authenticity and this friendly and authentic and I don't know how to say this kind of content goes very well, and that actually things are changing, and especially on TikTok, I noticed right now the content that works the best is like this super unglamorous, just they call it FaceTime content, and that makes me very hopeful that people are noticing these trends, that things get more extreme, and that they're actually sick of it. Because I also felt like in 2023 on TikTok especially, like the edits were getting crazy, people had like super professionally shot videos, like super edited, people also on Instagram, everything was looking perfect. And that is not working well. People are fed up by that. And I think that's like a natural stop to this whole increasing that people are actually getting sick of all of this perfection and glamorization. And
definitely. You were telling me a little bit about how you've noticed that the TikTok algorithm is favoring less curated, less glamorous, less edited content.
Yeah. I'm actually kind of pissed about that because, I don't know, I spend so much time like trying to perfect my videos, learning editing skills and learning all that stuff. And now that my videos can finally be glamorous and good looking, nobody wants to see that anymore. And it's all about just whipping your phone out and just talking in it without any cuts or editing and uploading it, and people find it relatable, and it's like, okay, perfect. Yeah. Learned that for nothing.
Yeah. It's interesting to consider the idea of curating authenticity and how for some people authentic means not edited, not filtered, but it could also mean unscripted or people or whatever it might be. I think part of it has to do with this idea of pattern interrupts. It's something that I think a lot about in my content. So when I first started posting content, was it 9 months ago? Lists were really, really big. It was like, here are five things that you need to have better mental health. Here are three things that piss me off. And it was an effective hook because people, they either liked it or they didn't. They either wanted to hear the list or they didn't. And then the people that heard the list were really, really engaged, and they listened to it and they shared the content and they commented their thoughts, and it was great. But then over time it stopped working as well. And now I've also noticed that what people really like in terms of what grabs their attention, in terms of what cuts through all the noise, is actually the kind of the non-hook hook, if you will, which is, oh, I'm just making tea. I'm just walking down the street. It's nothing gimmicky. It's not, this really pisses me off or this blew my mind. It's something I've been thinking about. It's just, you go straight into it or whatever it might be. Yeah. And so I bring all that up to say is that one of the things I've learned, and I really do view content creation with from such a psychological lens, given what I do, is that it's less about, one could argue, it's less about the authenticity versus not authenticity. And it's really similar to fashion, actually. What is fresh? What is new? what is the new thing for everyone's palette? Because I guarantee you in a year, I don't know if that's the exact timeline, but after some period of time, the non-hook hook, if everyone starts to do it, you're not going to stick out anymore.
Yes.
And so I don't think that those editing skills are completely to waste. And I think that you can still edit things to be relatable and authentic and still edit them and add animations and stuff that add a certain little something. I think the video that we've been talking about during this episode was edited and it had animations, and it all actually, I think, added to the really authentic message that you had or have.
Yeah. I really like that comparison, from fashion and content, because I really do see that, because I feel like in fashion as in content, there are like trends and there are like trend circles, and somebody tries something new And then everybody picks up on that. And once like the retail stores like H&M and Zara pick up on the same thing that the big designers are doing, it's out at that point. And then something new starts. And also that retro vibe, that some things are coming back in a different form. It's a good comparison. It's actually very similar to that. And maybe I can view it in that sense, as that things are coming back, and it's all about trends, and once learned skills are never going to waste. It's gonna benefit me in the long run.
Yeah, absolutely. It brings up this thing that we've been talking about implicitly. I want to take a few minutes to explore it, but this idea of getting desensitized to certain things. Mm-hmm. When you see, and I don't know how many hooks a social media user might see over the course of a day, of a week, of a month, I'm guessing hundreds. When you see hundreds of hooks that begin with, this is going to blow your mind, and here are five things that you need. And if you don't know this, the kind of more gimmicky hooks, if you will.
The last one will shock you.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Make sure to watch till the end, because the last one is the most important.
Oh my God.
and it's funny, because before I became a content creator, I used to resist it. And I actually got into it. I don't know if you and I talked about this, but I got into it on the advice of some friends and family and mentors in my life. They were like, you would be very, very good at it. And I'm very glad I listened to them, because it's, I do find it very meaningful, and I don't cringe anymore. And one of the reasons why I don't cringe is because I have seen firsthand that if I don't include that gimmicky little, and make sure to follow or whatever it is, the engagement actually goes down. And so, you know, it's kind of like, I have seen the metrics. The metrics do not lie. And you actually need to do that stuff sometimes, assuming that's what the trend is. And so I laugh about that sometimes. Proven. Because how quickly I became desensitized to my own cringe.
You know? Oh, God. Yeah, no. Being an influencer is one thing, but becoming an influencer, oh, you have to go through a lot of pain. I feel like.
Totally. No pain, no gain. And let's talk about desensitization, because it's actually something I think about in therapy all the time. And the idea is something like this. Let's say you come to see me for therapy and there's a problem. It doesn't really matter what the problem is, but in order to fix the problem, you got to talk about the problem. But the problem and all the things that are being affected by the problem are just too painful for you emotionally to actually discuss with me. What I need to do as a therapist, at least from the cognitive behavioral standpoint, and there are other theories about how to go about this, is I need to desensitize you to it. So we'll start out by talking about it. This is something I do with my couples all the time, because they come in and they get too dysregulated to talk about the thing that's happening between them in front of me. It becomes, people yell and they cry and it becomes this whole thing. And so what I say, okay, well, let's talk about talking about it. And they often get very, very annoyed, because they just want to talk about it, because they feel that sense of urgency, you know, which I totally understand. I definitely do, as someone that has been to therapy. I understand that. But without fail, it's less about setting up the conditions of satisfaction or the parameters of the conversation. That can certainly help, particularly with couples. But it's also about helping their nervous systems get a little bit desensitized to whatever the stimulating topic is. And so when you've talked about what is absorbing all of this content around beauty standards or fitness standards or whatever it might be, what is it doing to me? It is happening not all at once, but little bits over time. You're slowly desensitizing yourself, or conversely, you're resensitizing yourself to different experiences. The more often you think about, you mentioned earlier, quite courageously and vulnerably, I might add, sometimes I don't like my nose. Well, the way a therapist might help you with the body image stuff is not so much to say, just stare in the mirror and tell yourself how much you like your nose. No. Anyone who's listening to this, if positive affirmations work for you, that's great. Keep doing them. I'm not saying they don't work for some people. In my experience, both personally and clinically, they don't tend to work as well, because how many times can you possibly repeat that thing to yourself if you're absorbing hundreds of videos that make you feel self-conscious? It just, by the numbers, it just doesn't really add up. And so one of the things that you do with a patient like that is you say, hey, listen, your body is your body. Instead of thinking about your body in a different way, what if we think about your thoughts in a different way? How often do you think about your nose? Is thinking about your nose preventing you from putting yourself out there or doing the right pose that you need for the shoot? Is it actually impacting your function in the same way? Are these thoughts helping you? Are they going to help you get that gig? Are they going to help you get that date? Or it's more about the relationship to the thought than the content of the thought itself. And that can be really, really, I call it psychological gymnastics. I wish that was my term. It's not. It was given to me. But sometimes you can kind of get in touch with those different little dynamics of your mind. And it can be very, very helpful when you start to think about your mind that way. And I wonder what you think of that.
So not just to help me understand, it's not just that you try to eradicate these thoughts, but to sort of like accept them and to think about the thoughts and what they are doing with you.
Exactly. So you picked up on the two correct things. The first thing is, if you resist the thought just for the sake of resisting it, that may not always work. So if you actually think about your relationship to the thought, you can let it pass, but while not completely letting it all the way in without internalizing it. You know?
Okay, well, fair enough. I mean, honestly, it's good advice. I've yet tried to find ways to cope with all of these things with body images and all of that, and I think it's a very sensible approach to be like, okay, what are these, like, let those thoughts be and just sort of think about them and see what they're doing with you, and accepting that this moment is like this, accepting that your body looks like this in this moment. But I don't know. I feel like, because it's a similar story, but a little bit different, is with modeling. There's a lot of last minute-ness in the whole industry, and you sometimes have to wait out painfully long until you get like confirmations or rejections. Sometimes you don't even hear back from them at all. And it's very, very hard for me to not make myself go crazy during these times. And I also have this thought of you just have to accept it. You have to be in the moment. You have to state, this is how it is right now. And I tell myself that, but to actually achieve it, to actually do it, is insanely hard, to actually stay in the moment and accept the moment as it is. I don't know if you have any advice on how to do that, how to actually get better at that.
Yeah. So what the stand in the moment, the buzzword that comes up for me is mindfulness. And mindfulness is super important for therapy, for mental health. Most people, a lot of people, can benefit from mindfulness. But what's also coming up for me is that the confusing thing about mental health and mental health content as it's given in these like short form mediums on social media is that different tools are required at different times. So there may be times, let's say you're waiting to hear back about a contract, or what would you call it? Like
just a job. I went to a casting,
a job,
and the job is in 3 days. I have to go to another country for that job, and I'm waiting.
Okay. So you go to a casting, you're waiting to hear back about the job, and you notice anxiety or desperation, or you're overthinking about how you did when they were kind of assessing your fit for the for the job or for the project. There will be times where the correct tool is to practice mindfulness. Be present. Let yourself feel the anxiety, the fear, feeling self-conscious, and it will pass. Sometimes that's not going to help you. Sometimes the best thing that you can actually do is to not get super present to that emotion. Sometimes the best thing that you can do is to actually distract yourself and dissociate. So let me walk you through a little bit about what I mean, because it is confusing. Before I went to school, I thought that mindfulness was good for everybody, because that's what you hear. It's a, you know, meditation, enlightenment, being one. And I've had, as a younger, less experienced practitioner, I've had experiences with people, and not to toot my own horn, but I'm very good at facilitating meditation. I think it's something about my voice. I don't know what it is, but I'm really good at helping people get super, super present and in their bodies. And I've had this experience with more than one person where they get present in their bodies, they get super still, and what they get still and present and focused on is their baseline level of anxiety, panic, self-loathing, whatever it might be, and that is scary. And these patients in a clinical setting didn't necessarily have the tools to cope with such uncomfortable emotion, and so the mindfulness actually made them worse. Okay. One of the other things I'm trained in, clinical hypnosis, the way I like to describe clinical hypnosis is it's kind of the other side of the coin of meditation. So I don't know how to make you think you're a chicken or, you know, make you do silly stuff on stage. But if it comes down to a clinical need, it is something I do sometimes in my practice. And one thing that you can do with clinical hypnosis is you get people really, really relaxed, but it's different from meditation because you're relaxed, but you're not super present. In a way, you're actually dissociated. In a way, your mind is actually somewhere else. And then what you do is you get them really still, and they kind of lay down, you know, like this. But then what you do is you actually kind of wake them up from the neck up, and they sit down, but their body is very, very relaxed. And then you actually have them process the trauma, the anxiety, whatever it is, because it's not from a completely overwhelming, dysregulated place. For those of you who aren't familiar with hypnosis, it used to be kind of a woo-woo thing, maybe even 5 years ago, maybe more. There's a ton of research on it that's come out. It is a very legitimate modality for certain things. And one of the things I find it very helpful for is exactly that. This is really overwhelming right now. Let's actually take you out of it. And so a lot of people will say things like, oh, be mindful, feel your feelings all the time. And I want to go on the record as a licensed professional and say, absolutely not. Maybe okay. if that is working for you, then definitely do it. And it may work for you some of the time. But the other thing to consider is that avoiding feelings can actually be very adaptive. And the reason why is because if you avoid your feelings in the right way, and this is very different from not acknowledging them, from stuffing them down into your unconscious. This is more about distracting yourself so you don't act on them. Then that can actually be very, very adaptive. There is nothing inherently wrong with having a snack, going to the gym, scrolling on your phone or whatever it is, so you don't necessarily act on the emotion. Emotions are just, the way I like to think of them is they're data that's running through your nervous system. They're data that's running through your computer. You get to choose how you interpret that data and whether or not there's an output, whether or not there's a behavior that you want to do, or whether or not there's a thought process that you want to nurture and really, really think about. So that is what I would say to you, is to play with the idea of course, be mindful and present. I'm not saying don't be. I'm saying have the flexibility to sometimes talk yourself out of it. Go for a walk, distract yourself. Are you, the question I might ask you in that moment, if you were to call me for advice or for therapy, might be something like, is thinking about that shoot going to help you with your next one, or is it going to help you with your next task? Like, is this actually serving you in a particular way? If so, great. Let's talk about it. Let's get present. Let's you know, sometimes the way forward is through, but sometimes the way forward is around at the same time.
Amazing. Yeah. Well, first of all, I'm probably, after we wrap this up, waiting for the bill, because I'm getting a free therapy session with this whole thing. second of all, I think for me, this is actually comforting to hear, because I feel like the advice that people give you in these situations is the mindfulness thing. And I think it's comforting to hear that it's recognized that the mindfulness can be painful and too painful in certain situations, and that it's not always the best option. Because I don't know, sometimes it just I'm anxious as it is, and the mindfulness just puts me in agony, and it's good to hear for me that it's perfectly valid to distract myself from these thoughts, to put them away for another time or another day. So I like that advice. About the way to do that, though, I mean, the hypnosis thing I cannot really do by myself. But of course, the just going to the gym or having a snap or scrolling on your phone. Of course, that.
Well, tell me a little bit about, I was very curious to know, what is, because you're based in Austria?
Yeah, more or less, yeah.
Yeah. What is, and then maybe just talk about Europe in more in general, what is the mental health infrastructure like over there? Because I think, you know, in the United States, there are clinical hypnotists in every state, there are therapists in every state, some accept insurance, some don't. It's more or less accessible. It's, over the last couple of years, there's been this incredible both destigmatization around mental health, but also this popularization of talking about it. And I owe my content and its popularity to that popularization in a lot of ways. And I'm curious, do you experience the same thing over there in those countries and in those cultures? Is it something that's more talked about on the internet? I would love to know just what your subjective experience has been like.
So, I mean, I can speak for Europe as a whole, but in Austria more specifically. But I feel like that the situation would be pretty similar in the US and in Europe, because you know, therapists and everything, they're available, and I feel like it's a generational thing that the younger generation destigmatized mental health problems a lot. Especially, I don't know, I think in America it's probably the same, but in Austria with the older generations, it's still very stigmatized. People really rarely talk about that they're going to the therapist, whereas for the young people, it actually sometimes it seems to become sort of like a personal trait. It's like I'm the person who's like, I have anxiety and I'm going to the therapist, which sounds a bit rough, but I feel like some people make it part of their identity even. But yeah, generally, like the mental health landscape in Austria is like, therapists are very, very accessible for us. It is still like, it's still for the people who can afford them, because even though we have a lot of general health things covered by insurance, therapists are not really one of them. Like, most therapists have like one or two spots for severe cases that are paid for by insurance, and the rest has to pay for it themselves. So it is a bit of I don't want to say a luxury thing, but you have to be able to afford it. But we do have a lot of people. We have a lot of therapists. If I may share that, I have been to therapy and I had no problem finding someone to do so. So yeah, but I mean, I really want to get your take on this, because of this sort of being a trend among the young people to, because I feel like it has been destigmatized to talk about mental health and mental health issues, and I feel like it at some points overshot the mark, and it sort of became a thing that people started to identify with and to make part of their personality. And I feel like the destigmatization is of course an amazing thing, but when people use it to gain popularity or things like that, I want to hear your take on this, what this does to us, because I feel like it sort of takes the edge off of mental health issues, because if I say it very bluntly, if people then say, oh, I have depression, I'm sort of like, yeah, who doesn't? Like, everybody sort of makes this like part of their, at least in certain bubbles, part of their identity. So I was just wondering how you view that.
Yeah, it's something I touch on in my content. It's something that I'm writing about in an upcoming book. And it's something that we're going to talk a lot about on this podcast, not just with you, but with other guests, both directly and indirectly. Other mental health practitioners may disagree with what I'm about to say, but I feel like I have very good reasons to say what I'm about to say, and I'm not saying it off the cuff. It's something I've given a lot of thought to. And I am very concerned about the proclivity that people have to use diagnostic or mental health terminology to describe everyday experiences, because sometimes people come to therapy and they want the therapist to fix what we might call problems of living. Mm-hmm. Everyone has insecurities. Everybody has struggles in their relationships. Even if you grew up in what is could be considered a perfect family in a lot of ways, I'm sure there were still parts about it that were hard, emotionally speaking. And there is no therapist and no person, in my opinion, that can make all of that go away. And that's for two reasons. The first reason is half of your life is negative by definition. Now, your negative and unpleasant experiences might be different from someone else's. And I'm not saying that those differences aren't meaningful, but when it comes to the therapy session, when it comes to just the patient and the practitioner together, it's your subjective experience that really matters. And I say this to people all the time, both in my practice and outside of my practice, I don't know how to fix all of that, all those problems of living. I can certainly fix your mental disorder. I can certainly fix and that's also not to say that therapy can't help you figure out ways to tackle problems of living better. I think that it can, but to your point about the over-identifying with it, it's the thing that I find myself repeating ad nauseum is we already have language to describe the experience that you're talking about. So for example, narcissism is kind of a buzzword. Everyone's ex is a narcissist. And I make lots of videos and they perform quite well, by the way, where I say, listen, are they a narcissist? Or are they just really selfish? You know, were they immature?
There's a difference.
We actually have language for this already. And one of my theories is that people gravitate towards the clinical language for a few different reasons, but one of them might be it's an appeal to authority. Because think about it, if you and I are catching up just as friends and I'm complaining about my ex and I say, oh, they were really selfish, you might be like, oh yeah, man, like that sucks. Like I've been there, whatever. But there's nothing really to kind of say beyond that. But if I say like they were narcissistic, like I think they had a personality disorder, it's like, oh my God, Joe. Like, you know what I mean? Like that must have been so hard. Like, are you okay? And so it's not exactly exaggeration. It's this appeal to authority. It's using the authority that the psychology field has to assert whatever it is that you're trying to assert at the time. And it's a really easy trick to fall into it. I mean, I am tempted to fall into it a lot. And one of the things that I think has actually really helped me be more disciplined about it is by talking about it and making it part of something I talk about in my content and with people like you, because I do get concerned. I think that in terms of the identification, the last thing I'll say before I stop riffing here is that when it comes to kids, there's the concern that this could become maybe a core feature of their personality. But the thing you have to remember about kids, especially adolescents, is they're experimenting with identities all the time. That's just what teenagers do. And so the concern is that they start to maybe over-identify with their mental illness or their mental health struggle or their journey, and then it becomes a really core part of who they are. But part of me is also like, you know what? It's very normative for kids to try on these different hats. And I'm not totally convinced for every label, there might be some diagnostic labels that are more concerning than others, that it's as bleak as people think. For other people, I think that people love to feel validated and they love to feel known. And if this word that is now in vogue helps them do that, that's great. I just want everyone listening to this to understand that, you know, your diagnosis is not your destiny. It's a conversation I had on a different podcast recently. We talked about how if you're diagnosed properly, it is because there is hopefully a treatment plan to make you symptom free. So one of the things I've talked a little bit about is I have ADHD, and if I do what I'm supposed to do, people don't know, you know? And that's actually proof that my therapy worked, you know? And I prefer that more kind of empowering stint, because what I see with the identification piece that you're talking about is people are like, well, I have this and therefore I'm fine the way I am. And that's the wrong approach. The approach is you have this, and assuming you were labeled properly, you could be more than you are. And isn't that a wonderful thing?
That is a wonderful film. But I mean, on the subject, is just what concerns me about that is, first of all, like, we're back at the topic of being desensitized to it, because if I hear from so many people from so many areas they have depression, anxiety, ADHD, or whatever, I think it just makes you desensitized. It takes the edge off of these terms little by little until the people who really struggle with these things, who actually are diagnosed with these things, sort of don't get that recognized as that severe thing that it actually is, because people are just so desensitized to that. And the other thing is, what I thought about is, when you start to identify with these things, you don't really have an interest for these feelings to go away, because they're part of who you are now. They're part of your personality, and therefore you don't really want that to be fixed, because then you lose a part of who you are, right? And I think those are just two things that are a bit concerning about that whole thing.
It really, really concerns me too, and it will be interesting to see how these things develop and evolve. And it's a conversation that we can continue when we have you back on Therapy versus the World. Before we wrap up here, is there anything you want to leave the listeners with about you, or about anything that we talked about anything at all?
Leave them just to, touch back on being mindful, just with social media, with body standards, just to get a reality check every once in a while and be mindful about that this is a world that is sort of made to show the most perfect image that people want to present of themselves. Just to be aware of that and to just shift their focus to the real world a little bit more, because I catch myself getting lost in all of that. That's why I made this video, and it's important to be mindful about that.
All right, definitely. Well, for those who are listening, please go check out Paul Aaron Fischer's page on Instagram. And it sounds like you're also on TikTok. And please go like and subscribe Therapy versus the World on Spotify and on YouTube. It's totally free to do, and it's the number one way to support us. And if you really like what you're hearing, you can listen to Therapy versus the World ad-free and early only on Luminary.